One of the best ways to prevent plaque in your arteries is to reverse or prevent plaque and tartar in your teeth. I'm going to give you what's by far and away my best way to do that at home. Now, it's controversial, be aware, but I'm going to let you be the judge.
So as you see, I'm brushing first. Clean teeth, clean arteries.
How about if I told you that removing dental plaque and tartar can avoid further arterial plaque buildup and heart attacks? Yes, believe it or not. Years ago, I used to think that going to the dentist for teeth cleaning just wasn't that important for arterial plaque prevention and heart attack health. I was wrong. I learned about the connection between dental plaque and prediabetes and heart attack risk, and there's a lot to it. You see, it turns out the dental plaque and tartar increases the risk of heart attack by up to 44%. That's why it's important. That's why you want to remove it. Let me start by saying this, though. There are just no magical solutions. That's just the reality. There's discipline, and you get better at it, but you've got to have discipline in your oral hygiene. There are a couple of things to do at home that will help reduce both tartar and plaque and your risk of heart attack and stroke. Here's how it works. If you don't have the best oral hygiene, you don't clean out that food from the cracks between your teeth and your gums, that food stays there. And what happens when food stays there? It rots. It's ugly. And what does rotting mean? It means bacteria comes in and eats the rest of that food for you. Bacteria forms what we call a biofilm. That's what plaque is. It's a biofilm, and the bacteria is living in there eating that extra rotting food. Now, tartar is something different. It's not that slick biofilm. It's crust. It's mineralized. The bacteria eat all the food. They die. And then those dead bacteria lay there, and they get mineralized. It gets mixed with calcium phosphate, calcium carbonate, and magnesium phosphate in your saliva. Again, it gets mineralized and turns into a crust. And it's not pretty. It's yellow, brown, and even black. And maybe the black comes from the magnesium staining. You get bad breath. You get inflamed gums. The worst part is that leads to heart attacks. So how do you remove it? How do you get it out of there? First thing that I recommend is a good oral health cleaning protocol, starting with just plain simple brushing your teeth. And yes, make sure if you want to get phthalate-free or fluoride-free toothpaste. Baking soda toothpaste is fine, and so is dry brushing. Dry brushing is brushing without any toothpaste. It's not dry. You still use water. That's a basic step. 10 to 15 minutes after eating, at least twice a day. The second step is flossing and using dental floss, that string, especially where you have plaque. And it gets those places in between the teeth and between the teeth and the gums that brushing is just not going to get. You can brush all day long, and it's not going to get the place where that food really gets stuck in between your teeth. So brushing and using floss are really a bare minimum. And you might think, well, that still may not remove plaque. You know, have you ever had something in between your teeth and you flossed and it just sort of seems to move it around? You're right. Brushing and flossing alone won't remove tartar. They can help remove plaque, but there's another step, and I strongly recommend it. I recommend adding a water pick or water flossing. Evidence shows high success rates for dental hygiene, oral hygiene, removing that plaque and rotting food. To me, this is a critical three-step process. Now, let's look at how to use the water pick.
One of the things we've talked about a few times in recent videos is using a water pick. I've got a water pick here, a water flosser, but because of the tubes and the cords, I'm just going to use this travel water pick for demonstration purposes. Go up and start, and you want to get really between those teeth. I've got these teeth that get food caught in them, between them, and that's what these are really good for. It's good to keep your lips around the nozzle because then you can control where the water's going. Again, clean teeth, clean arteries.
You know, I tried water pick before, and I got tired of all those tubes and all that mess in the bathroom. I quit and neglected water flossing for years. I should not have done that. Yet one of the things that happened, and it was just a couple of years ago, I got something stuck down between my teeth and between the tooth and the gum, and I just kept flossing, couldn't get it out, flossing, couldn't get it out, tried those little picks, couldn't get it, rubber picks, couldn't get it out, and I started again back with water flossing. It got it out. There was actually places where I had tenderness in the gums between my teeth, and within a few days, it went away. I know you might be thinking, this three-step process just takes too much time. Having a clean mouth and all that protection from heart attacks, it's really worth it. You're going to gain more time back on healthy lifespan than you ever invest in good oral hygiene. Now, once you get rid of tartar, you better keep your teeth clean. The absolute best way to minimize tartar at home is to minimize plaque, that slick biofilm that we talked about earlier, the precursor of tartar. Just don't give that bacteria time to rot that food between your teeth or the bacteria and biofilm to start mineralizing. Don't leave it there. Don't give it the opportunity. Having dental plaque and periodontal disease increases your risk of heart attacks by up to 44%. So this is not just a nice to have. This is a must have. Periodontal disease has been associated with over 65 different diseases. Heart attacks, as we've mentioned, but strokes, other types of arterial disease like kidney disease, blindness, erectile dysfunction, and type 2 diabetes. Even cancer and guess what? Dementia, Alzheimer's. There's just so much evidence showing that bacteria can travel from your mouth to your heart by way of your arteries. Here's a paper. It was published by our friends, David Vigorist, Brad Bale, Amy Dunning. It showed very clearly that bacteria in the mouth is related to prediabetes, diabetes, and arterial plaque buildup. So again, for those of us like me who are a little bit more academic, a little bit more science-oriented, and said, well, maybe it's not the periodontal disease that causes the heart attack. Maybe it's something else causing both periodontal disease and heart attack. That part is very, very true. It's prediabetes and diabetes. But again, to go back to this paper, Brad and Amy and David showed that it's not just the prediabetes causing both. Periodontal disease, as it increases, causes more and more risk for heart disease. Here's a bigger problem. Prediabetes is pretty much associated with periodontal disease and cardiovascular disease. That's what I just said, right? Have you had an oral glucose tolerance test? Have you had an insulin response, a Kraft insulin survey? If not, how do you really know that your body can metabolize carbs? In other words, how do you know that you're not one of those 50% or more of us over age 18 that have prediabetes? Well documented. Or 85% of us 60 and older that have prediabetes. Because 90% of us that have it don't know it. And why is that? Because 3/4 of our primary care doctors, internists, family practitioners, and cardiologists don't know how to diagnose it. So let's go back and make sure that you know if you have prediabetes or not. Let's make sure you know your level of metabolic health. Now, let's go back to gums for a minute. Have you had bleeding gums or tenderness or pain when you go to the dentist? Especially when they bleed, that's a clear sign of prediabetes. And either way, whether you have prediabetes or not, it's also a sign of cardiovascular risk. And as I've said before, once you start putting all of these comorbidities, these related chronic diseases together, like periodontal disease and prediabetes, the risk just keeps adding up for heart disease. Now, that may sound like I'm spreading bad news. I'm not. I'm actually even saying the opposite. If we do the right things in terms of managing our body, keeping our body fat low, our muscles strong, and good oral health, just think of the magnitude of cardiovascular risk, heart attack risk, stroke risk, blindness risk, kidney disease, erectile dysfunction risk, all of those risks that we can just take right off the table. So, you know, I mentioned that article by David Vigorous, Brad Bale, and Amy Dineen talking about how bacteria in the gums can actually be found in plaque. There was another study that showed it looked at people that had had a heart attack, and it looked at the clots that they removed from the heart attack, and over half of them had bacteria in them, the same bacteria that came from the mouth. So Brad and Amy and David's research is not the only, they're not the only studies showing this linkage of risk between oral health, prediabetes, diabetes, and cardiovascular disease. I've gone over a lot of those comorbidities. That may not be the worst part. The worst part might be this, at least in the oral health story. Over half of the population worldwide has periodontal disease. In a way, your typical dentist is very much like your typical doctor. They get up and they go to work every day, and they trip over half of their population with significant evidence of heart attack and stroke risk. And they don't know how to diagnose it. Ask your dentist what portion of his or her patients have bleeding gums. And then ask your doctor what portion of his or her patients have prediabetes. So, again, the prediabetes may be increasing your risk of gum problems, but your oral hygiene is a critical factor. If you're thinking, well, prediabetes is genetic, it's due to my genes, my family, I can't do anything about that. Or I'm 60 years old, that's what's causing my problem, I can't fix that. You're wrong. You're flat wrong. Yes, genetics may load the gun, but lifestyle pulls the trigger. Remaining thin with strong muscles minimizes the risk of diabetes, no matter what your genetics. Also, oral hygiene is a critical part of lifestyle. Removing tartar goes far beyond just a beautiful smile. There's one way to remove tartar, and we haven't discussed it yet. Using a dental scaler works. Now, be really clear. I'm not recommending that you buy a dental scaler. That's an instrument. It's made out of metal. It's got a hook on it with a very sharp end on that hook. You can do damage to the enamel of your teeth, if not to your gums, if you go trying to remove your tartar yourself using a scaler. That's an activity for a dental professional. A hygienist or a dentist needs to be doing that for you. Don't try scaling at home. The best way to remove dental plaque and tartar, at least visit your dentist, get a professional cleaning, and then do good daily oral hygiene. The bare minimum, again, is the daily brush, floss, and water pick. Now, I haven't mentioned those other remedies that you can see online, like chili peppers, baking soda, hydrogen peroxide, ascorbic acid. There are manufactured kits using all these things. And I'm not saying don't ever use them. There may be a time and a place, especially for some of these. But what I am saying is, again, go back to the very basics. Brushing, flossing with floss, and then floss with water floss or a water pick. That's the best way to manage your oral health at home. And then go see a professional. You also might be familiar with Dr. Ellie Phillips. She has a method for removing tartar. I don't use that. I can't recommend for or against it. Now you know the best way to remove dental plaque, to prevent tartar at home, what to do and what not to do. But to understand more about why removing tartar and dental plaque is important and how it decreases the risk of heart attacks, check out this podcast. The link should appear somewhere around here.